Today in this video, I want to discuss about OSI model and how it relates to a real-world scenario where Node 1 wants to communicate to Node 2. The first requirement that OSI defines is to provide a physical medium through which the communication is going to happen. The physical medium can be wired using copper, fiber, or other types of cables, or it could be wireless using radio frequency waves. Regardless, the physical medium is the means through which the actual bits of information are going to travel. Here we are going to select a crossover cable and connect it to Ethernet interfaces of each node. If you don't know what a crossover cable is yet, that is fine. Now, the physical layer requirements of the OSI model is fulfilled. Next, we are going to move to data link layer requirements. Data link layer defines the rules and regulations on how the two directly connected nodes are going to communicate over the physical medium. There must be a mutual understanding between the communicating nodes so that they can interpret the meaning of the bits that is received from the physical medium. We are going to go to each node and configure these link layer settings. On node 1, which is connected on its fast Ethernet interface, we need to make sure that the port status is on, the bandwidth is preferably set to maximum speed, and duplex mode is set to full duplex. We are also going to define a MAC address of our own. However, by default, the MAC address is always set by the network interface card manufacturer and is unique to that interface across the world. Anyway, we need to head to node 2 and make sure that the configurations are exactly the same as node 1, but with a different MAC address. Now, the requirement for link layer is fulfilled. However, there is still not communication happening as we can see in the simulation mode. Next, we are going to fulfill the requirement of network layer. That is basically to define a unique IP address to each node, so that each node is uniquely identified across the local area network, and it can be reached using that address. For node 1, we are going to configure a 192.168.0.1 address with default subnet mask. The subnet mask defines the network portion and host portion of the address. Let's head to node 2. We configure the network portion of the IP address exactly the same as node 1, 192.168.0, and set the host portion as 2, which is unique to this device. Now we can see that communication is starting to happen. ARP messages are exchanged between the nodes, which helps each node to find out about MAC address of other nodes in the network. ARP functions at layer 2 of OSI model, so you can see that only layer 1 and layer 2 details are available for this packet. If we want to confirm connectivity on layer 3, we can use ping, which in turn uses ICMP and ICMP functions at layer 3 of OSI model. We will go to node 1, go to desktop, and then command prompt. Type the command ping followed by the address of node 2. As you can see, the pings are going through. If we look at the ICMP packets, they consist of details up until layer 3. Thus, the requirement for network layer or layer 3 is fulfilled. Additionally, let's configure node 2 as web server and node 1 as web client so that we can see the communications happening in the upper layers of OSI model. Go to node 2. Go to services. Go to HTTP and turn on the services. Subsequently, we head back to node 1, close command prompt, open web browser, and request from server address. The web page is loaded successfully. If we open the HTTP packets, we can see that HTTP functions at layer 7 of the OSI model and depends on the lower layers for network connectivity. The most important things to understand about the OSI model are: we can divide up the protocols into layers. Layers provide encapsulation. Layers provide abstraction. Layers decouple functions from others. I hope this video helped you understand better the role OSI model plays in networking. Please don't forget to like this video and subscribe to this channel.